This alone shall be my prayer. Glorify thy name. Be glorified in me. Be glorified. Be glorified in me. Be glorified. Can a child presume to choose where or how to? Let my glad heart while it sings thee in all proclaim, and whatever the future brings, glorify thy name. Be glorified in me. Be glorified in me. Sorrow, pain, or care, freedom there I claim. This alone shall be my prayer. Glorify thy name. Glorify. Be glorified,
Jesus.
Shine, would you shine, shine, shine through me, shine in me, outshine the darkness around me,
shine
through me, be glorified, be lifted high, be magnified,
be
even in my life, your transforming power, oh, the Holy Spirit's fire, be glorified, Lord. Be glorified in me.
Be glorified.
Be glorified.
morning where we can all stay together at home with our families, yet worship you together as one body of believers. God, I ask that you would make us so aware of your presence wherever we are, so in tune with your voice and your spirit and the ways that you will be moving this morning. Open our hearts and our minds to hear your word. We invite you in to do whatever it is you want to do. We give you everything we have. We bow before you. We love you so much, Father. Pray all this in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. Chains be broken. Lives be
chains Good morning, Mount Carmel family and friends. Welcome to our worship service this morning here on Facebook live stream. I am absolutely thrilled to be here, to be with you, and to worship Jesus, who is in control of absolutely everything. So we come today to worship him and to acknowledge his control over our lives, over our nation, over our world, over all creation. He's on the throne, and we come to worship him. So thank you for joining us. I know some of us are new to Facebook, at least I am. So I want to encourage you. We've been reaching a number of people through live streaming our worship service. I mean, between 1,000 and 2,000 people every week. And the way that people find out about our worship service is through you and through me, either liking our page, our church page, or following our church page. You can follow our church page, and you can also share this worship service. So we'd encourage you to share this service, to like our page, to follow our page. I have no idea what the difference between either one of those are, but apparently it makes a difference. So if you want to get the word out about our ministry and about this time in particular that we're spending together, that's just a very easy way to do it each and every week. So let me call you to worship Jesus, who is on the throne. We'll use Psalm 24 this morning. Hear God's word and prepare your hearts to come and to worship him. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully. He will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory, the Lord of hosts? He is the King of glory. Here in Western PA, it's rainy outside, it's gray outside, but nevertheless, we're going to come and worship Jesus, who is on the throne. Let's praise him in song.
Refuge, my treasure, Lord, you
I love that each week we can come together before the throne of God and confess our sins. Jesus welcomes us to do that, to come and to bear our souls, to bear our hearts, and to do that not in isolation, but together, because we are all in need of forgiveness. So I'd invite you to pray this prayer of confession along with me. And as we pray it, we'll even prepare our hearts to silently confess our sins to the Lord. Let's pray together. Almighty God, you have raised Jesus from death to life and crowned him Lord of all. We confess that we have not bowed before him or acknowledged his rule in our lives. We have gone along with the ways of the world and failed to give him glory. Forgive us and raise us from sin, that we may be your faithful people, obeying the commands of our Lord Jesus Christ, who rules the world and is head of the church, his body. Amen. Let's silently confess our sins to the Lord. Of the gospel. God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. In Christ, by God's grace, we are saved. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Let's continue to worship him in song.
Oh,
Amen. Thank you, Jordan, for leading us in worship. Thank you, Joe and Christian in the back, helping with our intimidating equipment. Appreciate you all being here. We are going to be in Acts chapter 1 today. Finishing our mini-series on the glory of God in the resurrection. And as we turn to Acts chapter 1, I got questions, and so do you. When will all this be over? Do you find yourself asking that question throughout the course of the day? And the week, or maybe you're asking questions like, when will we be able to? When will we be able to get back to work? When will we have a thriving economy again? When will we not live in fear? When will we be able to trust in information that we see on our news feeds? Or on our screens? When will we be able to have a government that doesn't seem to be fighting among themselves? When will we not live in isolation? When will we have our kids go back to school and get out of our house? Perhaps some of you are asking that question. We ask questions all the time, especially, I think, during times of difficulty, times of pandemics. What questions do you have for God? Well, in Acts chapter 1 today, the disciples, before Jesus ascends up into heaven, they have a question, and it's the question that really encompasses all the questions that you and I are asking. That question is found in Acts chapter 1. Now, before I read this, I want to just take a moment, because we are going to read a story here that is absolutely incredible. And it's easy, especially if we've been in the church for a while, to read stories like this and to just sort of glance over it. But what I am about to read is absolutely incredible. Jesus, who was crucified on the cross, resurrected himself from the dead 3 days after he died. And for 40 days, he showed himself, his resurrected body, to many people, including these disciples. And now they find themselves on the mountaintop, and they are about to see the resurrected Jesus, who has a real body like you and I, be lifted up into the air and to go out of their sight. That's amazing. That is absolutely astonishing. So as we come to God's word today, I would hope and pray that we all come astonished for about what we are going to hear. Acts chapter 1, we'll begin our reading in verse 6. Friends, this is God's word. So when they had come together, they asked him, Jesus, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. We'll end our reading there. Let's pray for God's blessing on the preaching of his word. Father in heaven, we pray that you would bless the preaching of your word. That you would speak to us through it. That you would encourage us. That we would come to know Jesus, to be in awe of him, and be changed by him. We pray these things through Christ. Amen. And amen. So it is official. Children everywhere have changed the question that they always ask. And this question, parents have heard for centuries upon centuries. Whether they drove in a horse cart buggy, or whether they rode in a vehicle, or whether they walked along a path. And the question that kids have been asking forever is, are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? That question has been replaced by a new one, and it's this. When can we go? When can we go? I can't tell you how many times I have heard that one over the past month. When can we go back to school? When can we go to my friend's house? When can we go to this activity and this activity? When is this all going to end? When can we go to the computer so that we can order something off of Amazon? Oh my goodness. Are we there yet has been replaced by when can we go? You see, we live in a moment in time that we want to know the future. Our kids want to know the future. They want to know when they can get back to normal. This is not a new concept to humanity. Humanity has always wanted to know when this and that is going to happen. After the fall of our first parents, we've been asking that question. And that's the very question that the disciples here are asking Jesus as he is about to ascend into heaven. We see it in verse 6 when they've gathered together. One more question they have, the last question that they get to ask the resurrected Jesus. Will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? Is this when you're going to make all things right again? is essentially what they are asking Jesus. And Jesus does not tell them the answer to their question. But he says this in verse 8, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses." Jesus does not answer their question, but gives them a mandate. And he doesn't give them a mandate that includes them trying to figure it out. He says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses. Even during those times when you ask the questions. That's really the main point of this text this morning. It's because we, as the people of God, will receive the Holy Spirit. We receive the Holy Spirit whenever we come to faith in Christ. Because we've received the Holy Spirit, we will have power to be witnesses for Jesus, even during the seasons of our questioning. And I'd say in particular during those seasons is when the Holy Spirit will empower us to witness for Jesus. Well, what does Jesus want us to say? Well, I think we see in our text three things that Jesus wants us to witness to others about him. The first is that Jesus is on God's throne. Jesus is on God's throne. Jesus wants us to tell other people that. And not just to tell them that, that we would be so impacted by that, that it would change our lives. Jesus wants us to witness that he is on God's throne. And number two, he wants us to witness that Jesus is implementing God's plan. God has a plan that is being implemented by Jesus, who sits on God's throne. And finally, Jesus wants us to be witnesses that he is coming back again. Those are the three things that we are called to as believers in Christ to witness about the risen Jesus. That he's on God's throne, that he's implementing God's plan, and that Jesus is coming back again. And he doesn't leave us to do it in our own strength, but he says, I've given you the Holy Spirit to empower you to be my witnesses that Jesus is on his throne. After all, that's what our text tells us this morning. And verse 9, there on the mountaintop, after he had given these words of instruction and encouragement that they would receive the Spirit of God that would empower them to be his witnesses. Verse 9 says that he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. Well, where did he go? He went up into heaven, out of their sight, to go and to do what he said all along he would do, and that is sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Through his death and through his resurrection, Jesus has now qualified himself to sit on the very throne of God. people who sit on thrones reign kingdoms. And that's what Jesus has the authority to do now that he is at the right hand of God the Father. He sits on the very throne of God and reigns over the entire creation with infinite power, with infinite wisdom. That's where Jesus is at, on the throne, reigning forever and ever. And it's this Jesus that says, it is not for you to know the times and the seasons. When the disciples ask, when will you come and restore everything back to the way it's supposed to be? Jesus says, I'm not telling you when. And he's allowed to say that because he is on the throne and he reigns. I realize that some of us don't like that, but that's who Jesus is. He is God on the throne, reigning over all creation. I came across a snippet of a sermon that the famous preacher Billy Graham preached on Habakkuk. Habakkuk is a Old Testament book. I'd encourage you to go and check that out this week. The structure of it is quite simple. Habakkuk, the prophet, voices a complaint to God, or he asks a question, and then God answers him. It happens, I believe, 3 times. But at the very beginning of this book, Habakkuk's questions can be summarized as a familiar question, one that perhaps we might be asking. And it's this: Lord, please tell me what you are doing. Everything seems to be falling apart. Can you tell me the future? Or, to wrap that nicer, can you tell me what your plan is? And this is God's response in Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 5. He says, look among the nations and see, wonder and be astounded, for I am doing a work in your days that you would not believe if I told you. That you would not believe if I told you. And Billy Graham unpacks that and says, if God today told us what he was doing in our world, we would not believe it. Don't you dare think God's given up, that God's abdicated and left his throne. He hasn't. He's still on the throne. And those of us that know him put our trust in him and in him alone. I don't put my trust in Washington. I don't put my trust in the United Nations. I don't put my trust in myself. I don't put trust in my money. I put trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. When all the rest of it fails and crumbles and shatters, he will be there because he's on the throne. That's awesome. That's the reality. Even during this pandemic and the questions that we are throwing out there, which are good questions to ask. God gets glory when we ask questions about our circumstances. And when these circumstances, especially the negative ones, are going to end, We need God's power to really believe, speak, and live this out, that we are trusting in Jesus who sits on the throne. You see, this is what it means to be witnesses of Jesus. Don't you want that power to believe that Jesus really is reigning right now? That he is on the throne. Well, I have good news for you, potentially. You have that power. Because if you're in a right relationship with God, you've received the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will empower you to believe that Jesus is on the throne. And he's reigning. And he's in control. And if you're not yet in a right relationship with God, you can be. Through faith that Jesus died on the cross for your sins. To forgive you. To reconnect you spiritually with God. So that you would be in a right relationship with him and receive the Holy Spirit to give you power even in the midst of your deepest questions. You see, God's Spirit will empower us to trust in Jesus' reign. What are your false trust? What are your false trust? When I heard that list that Billy Graham threw out there, when he said, I don't put my trust in Washington. My goodness, how many of us have fallen into the trap that our government is our savior? That science is our savior? That stimulus packages are our savior? How many of us have fallen into the trap and trusting in ourselves and our own power instead of just admitting our weakness and our need for Jesus who sits on the throne and reigns? How many of us have put our trust in our money? And as we see our economy tank, as we see our investments go down, as some of us experience a cutback in hours or even a loss of a job, our hearts are being exposed to our false trust. And Jesus says, if you've received the Holy Spirit, he will empower you to trust him. Even when everything else seems to be crumbling, when all the created things that we put our trust in go by the wayside. Jesus here invites us to take the view of the disciples who are on that mountain, and they see Jesus ascend up into the air to go and to sit on the throne of God. Would you come with me and be there and see Jesus go to his throne? I'm curious, how has Jesus empowered you to trust him in this pandemic? That's something that you can witness and testify about even now. And share that on our Facebook Live comment section. How has God empowered you to trust that he is on the throne and he's reigning? Or maybe this is an opportunity for us to testify and to witness in what ways we're trying to trust Jesus to empower us to trust him during this pandemic. Where do you need Jesus to empower you to trust him as we walk through this season of difficulty? friends, our friends and our family need to hear and be reminded of this simple reality, that Jesus is reigning and he is in control. That's our call to witness to that reality. And the wonderful thing is that the Holy Spirit will empower us to do that. We're called to witness to Jesus' reign on God's throne. And we're also called, and we receive the Holy Spirit that gives us power to witness that Jesus is implementing God's plan. It's almost funny when we read this story and we see in verse 10 and at the beginning of verse 11, the response of the disciples here. They're asked this question by these two people in white robes. It says, while they were gazing into heaven, as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven?" I wonder how long they were there, just looking up in awe of who Jesus is. They're just standing there. It's probably 20 minutes, I bet. That would get my attention if I saw a person ascend into the sky and then disappear. I'd be like, wow, that's incredible. We get a little glimpse of what was going on there at the end of the Gospel of Luke, who also wrote Acts. He says that they were worshiping Jesus and that they had great joy. They were there, they had just seen this miraculous event, and they are there in awe of Jesus, worshiping him, and they have great joy. And then these two men come and ask him, "Well, what are you doing?" And in verse 11, these two men say, "Why do you stand there looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." They're essentially saying, you need to get going. Jesus told you to go to Jerusalem and to wait to receive the Holy Spirit. You need to move from awe of who Jesus is to action. And let me tell you that these guys were never more motivated to implement God's plan than at this very moment. They were ready because they were seeing Jesus for who he really is. This reminds me of one of my best friends when they got married, had a bachelor party, and we all went to a mutual friend's house who lived on this man-made lake. And it was during the summer, and it had to be the perfect day. It was the perfect temperature. And as we stood there and looked out across this small man-made lake that was stocked with fish that were just eager and hungry to be caught, the water was calm. The trees were beautiful. And we knew that something absolutely wonderful was about to take place. But we were in awe of the scenery. We were in awe of the opportunity that was before us. But we had to move from being in awe of that to actually fishing, to baiting our hook and getting in the boat and throwing the hook into the water with the bait and catching the fish and reeling them in. You see, there's a difference between being in awe and then actually doing something. And that's what we have happening here. The disciples are in awe of who Jesus is. And now they're encouraged to go and do something. Respond to it. Stop standing there looking up into the sky and go. And do what God has called you to do. You see, God's Spirit will empower us to implement the plan of Jesus. Jesus, who sits on the throne of God, has a plan and he's implementing it, and he's chosen to use people like you and me to implement it. And what motivates us to want to implement it is to see Jesus for who he really is, the one who reigns on the throne. We have opportunity during this pandemic to go and to show radical love towards our neighbors, to our coworkers, to our family. And as we step out in faith and go and pursue those relationships, have those conversations, I want us to be reminded that the Holy Spirit that lives within us, resides in us, will empower us. He will give us the right words at the right time. He will bring the right people into our path at the right time. He will give us boldness. He will give us discernment. He will give us a burden for people. He will give us a motivation like we've never had to pray for people. He will empower us to go and to serve and to go and to reach out to witness that Jesus reigns, that Jesus is Lord, that Jesus is Savior. We can't just be in awe of who Jesus is. We can't just keep staring up into the sky. But that is meant to move us into implementing the plan that Jesus has. And lastly, because we've received the Holy Spirit, we will have power to witness that Jesus is coming back again. That's what it says in verse 11, that he will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Jesus' return is the answer to their question. And it's the answer to all of our questions. That Jesus is coming back to bring restoration, to make things the way that they're supposed to be, to do away with death, with viruses, with sickness, with mourning, with pain, with all the messed upness of this world. Jesus is coming again to make it all right. And it's important to tell ourselves that, and it's important to tell others that as well. Not what Jesus is saving us from, but what he is saving us to. I came across a story from Focus on the Family. I believe this is Dr. Dobson sharing a story about a 5-year-old African American boy who will never be forgotten by those who knew him. He was sick and he had lung cancer, which is a terrifying disease in its final stages. Lungs fill up with fluid. Patients are unable to breathe. There's a claustrophobic feeling, especially for small children. But this little boy had a Christian mother who loved him and stayed by his side during this long ordeal. And there was this nurse that would come in and say what this mom was experiencing with her little sick son. And at the final moments, the final hours of his life, he said, "The bells are ringing, Mommy. I can hear them." And the nurse thought that he must have been hallucinating as he was slipping away. And she left for a couple moments, came back, and he was still talking about these bells. And the nurse, in a way of trying to bring comfort to the mother, said, "He's probably just hallucinating. He doesn't really hear anything." And the mother quickly said, "No. He does hear bells," as she pulled the young child closer to her and said, "No, he's not hallucinating. I told him when he was frightened, when he couldn't breathe, if he would listen carefully, he could hear the bells of heaven ringing for him." That is what he's been talking about all day. That precious child died in his mother's lap later that evening, and he was still talking about the bells of heaven when the angels came to take him away. Whatever you and I are experiencing during this pandemic, which is a bunch of awful things, Jesus and his return isn't just meant to restore all those things, as great as that is. But we have something to look forward to. The welcome of heaven. Everlasting life. In a world that has no death and no sickness and no pain and no corruption. When everything functions the way that it was meant to be. I can't think of a better hope to have and to tell people who are struggling and have no hope as things are crumbling around them than the return, the bodily, physical return of Jesus. The hope of heaven. Will you tell somebody? Will you witness? God will empower you to be bold and courageous as we step out in faith to tell people this is not the end of the story. It's the beginning of something wonderful when Jesus comes back. Are we there yet? When can we go? All these questions our kids are asking along with us are all part of this question. When is Jesus coming back? I don't know. And Jesus doesn't tell us. But he says, "I will give you the Holy Spirit who will empower you to be my witnesses. Could it be that God is doing such a wonderful work in our hearts and in our world that we wouldn't believe it, even if Jesus told us when he was coming back? As we wait by the power of God's Spirit, we will be his witnesses that Jesus is on God's throne, implementing God's plan until Jesus comes back again. Amen. As we wait, we pray. What we pray to Jesus, who is on the throne of God. I'll lead us through the prayers of the people. Would you pray with me? Jesus Christ, mediator and high priest, we thank you for becoming human and for experiencing the joys and sorrows of life, which assures us that you are able to sympathize and rejoice with us. We praise you for the many joys of life. For the beauty of creation. What are some of the things that you saw in God's creation this past week, which you would like to praise him for? Share that with us as we pray for your work in this world, Lord. How are we seeing God at work? Would we give him praise for that? For the greatest source of our happiness, the gift of eternal life. Father in heaven, thank you that you did not leave us in our sins, in our spiritual death, but you brought us hope. You brought us Jesus, born of a virgin, who lived an absolutely sinless life, who went to the cross and died in our place so that we could be brought back into a relationship with you. A right relationship, a relationship that we believe by faith, because you have given us the gift of faith to believe it. Give that gift to every single person who is listening in and participating in our worship service. Give that gift of faith, Lord, to family and friends that we know. This gift of eternal life, this hope that we have, would you give it in abundance? Help us to be a part of that, to experience that in our lives and in the lives of others as we witness to who you are. As our mediator, Jesus, you stand before God, petitioning him on our behalf, so we boldly bring before you our prayers for the nations of this world. Is there a nation on your heart, friends, that you would like to pray for? Our nation and our leaders, Father, we need you. You are the true leader. You are the true king. But you use, Lord, national leaders, state leaders, county leaders, Father, to accomplish your plan. So we pray for them and pray that you would bless them and give them wisdom and help them to make good decisions for our country, for our world. Lord, we pray for our community, for those in authority. We pray for the church universal as it works on your behalf. Father, raise up your people to witness of Jesus. We pray, Lord, for our local church and our ministry, Father. Help us to minister to one another, to spur one another on towards love and good deeds, to encourage one another, to be unified as a family of God, to be a corporate witness, Lord, to our community. And Father, of course, we have persons with particular needs that are on our hearts. Lord, hear our prayers. We lift them up to you. Lord, people have lost loved ones in our church community. Lord, would you be with them and their families? People have had hours cut back from their jobs. Some people have lost their jobs. Would you provide? Would you help them to trust you as they walk through this valley? Lord, we pray all these things in the strong name of Jesus, our mediator and high priest. Amen. As we go into our offering song, I invite you to worship through giving. You can certainly do that on our website, Give Online, or there's information about where you can send your tithe and your offering, the address to the church. So it's not only give our money in a form of worship, but give God our very lives. We are yours, Lord. Use us to witness about Jesus.
I won't be afraid. You don't let me.
stood before creation, eternity in your hands. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now is still. You stood
Thank you for worshiping with us this morning, today, or maybe this week. I am going to be praying for you in particular, that, and for myself, that we will live as people who believe that Jesus is on the throne of God, reigning, empowering us to be his witnesses. Would God give us those opportunities this week? Receive God's blessing from Ephesians chapter 3. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen and amen. Go in his peace. Thanks for worshiping with us. Hit that share button.
I can see your heart in everything you make. Every burning star, signal, fire of grace. And if creation sings your praises, so will I. You were spoiled.